Please give a warm welcome to Yella Herald. He's almost ready here. He's been working on this the whole time to be ready for tonight.
Can you hear me?
There you go.
All right. Microphone. So this is a sticker. They just arrived. They were cut by my colleague Sensei Post, who's all the way in the back, who's also working on the system. So if you want a sticker afterwards, that's that. And then, oh yeah, let me switch off my thing that makes me sleep. It's called Flux. There we go again. Yeah. So a little bit about me. You can find me here on Twitter. I think that's enough about me because there's not more time. A little bit about Statebox. This is also the conclusion, but it's a visual language for speaking about multi-party protocols. And hopefully during the talk it will become clear what that is. It also tries to make a point about abstract algebra and proofs and using those to guarantee that your program has well-defined behavior and that it's portable across different chains or different systems. And hopefully it will become a little bit clear why this is well-suited as a contract language for distributed ledger systems, which is the fancy name for blockchains. Okay, I can do that later. Outline of the talk, I'll quickly go over the history of this system, the history of mathematics behind it, give you some more background in the bigger picture. Then how would you approach solving this problem? So we'll go from state machines to patternets to Statebox. Then I'll show a demo of the current situation, which is, you'll see. And then what's up next? So ICO, research, and finally, I'll try to leave some time for questions. So history, this thing was conceived in 2003 already by a guy named Ray Dasse. He was my colleague at the time, and it was how we could make software, like we keep getting the same customers coming and, let me just skip it. 2003, it was built. 2008, we moved this to the JVM and the cloud, so this was still centralized. And at the time, I started realizing, wait, we can do something similar to blockchains, which then around that time happened. So I got early on into the whole Bitcoin situation. We conceived something similar to Ethereum as well around the time. And then Ethereum came, we're like, oh, this is starting to look like it. And so now we're in 2017 with distributed ledgers and ICOs. So anyway, someday I'm looking at a physics lecture and I see this. Like, that's pretty interesting. Some guy has a formula and a diagram for the formula. In fact, you can even do equations over diagrams. So you can say this diagram is equal to the other diagram. And this reminded me of something else I was doing at the time. So you have modular audio synthesis. It's the idea of taking divide and conquer, where you have little modules, you connect them together, and you can build your own synthesizer patches. This also appears in video processing things, so 3D modelers, things like that. You see it in high-frequency trading systems or large-scale cloud systems like, let's say, Facebook. It's based on events, event processing architectures. In business process modeling, so you have a business process. There is semi-formal this is kind of a formal language, business process modeling notation to describe business processes. Can this be unified somehow? Is there some form of, it seems very similar. Can we do something with this? But why would we want to do this? Well, if you have a big system, you get very gnarly issues. These things tend to explode. They tend to be super expensive to maintain. They're often domain specific. So the program I showed you for the audio synthesizer is very different from the video synthesizer. You cannot connect these things. they often have ill-defined or incomplete defined behavior and can lead to hacks. So this should sound familiar to stuff happening in the blockchain right now. Can we do something like composite diagrams? Can we somehow use these diagrams to do this? And first of all, is there some mathematics for this? Is there something that says, I have some processes, and if I put them together, I get cookie dough? Turns out there is. This is called operat theory. It took me a long time to discover this, but it's basically how you make bigger things out of smaller things. You can even do this with wires in between them. So this is starting to look a lot like the diagrams, and the guy that popularized or kind of invented it, well, didn't. Mathematics very subtle, but David Spivak, he's one of the major people in this field. He's actually the advisor for Statebox Project, so I'm very happy about that. But anyway, behind this composition is that idea that if you have a square thing with three square holes in it, and you give me three square things, if I put those together, again, I have a square without any holes. So this is this abstract composition operator. Now the question is, if we want to do this with diagrams, what do we compose over? So what goes in the squares? We wanted to speak about composite process diagrams. And so this is basically what this state box system is. So it's using all kinds of fancy mathematics and tricks to, in the end, try to come up with something very, very simple that has a lot of powerful features. So what is a process anyway? In computer science, it's a little bit vague, and that's kind of part of the problem. You have an algorithm, like checking the signature of elliptic curve, checking if the elliptic curve signature is correct. Smart contracts kind of run on their own. They execute a transaction, so that looks a little bit like an algorithm. But then you have these other things, like a network protocol, so a Byzantine fault-tolerant network like Bitcoin itself. These people engage in a protocol. So that's just an algorithm is in one place, and a network protocol is about communication. In physics, you have something similar processes. There are Feynman diagrams, particles interacting. If you generalize this for string theory, you place a particle with a string, you get these kind of tube things. And then it turns out that you can combine those. So if I have one circle here and two circles down there, and then two circles up here and one circle down there on the boundary, these things are called cobordisms, you can compose them. So this is starting to look like programming now, because I have an x and a function from x to y, and a y and a function from y to z, then I get a function from x to z. So that's interesting. When I saw this, I was like, So we have a connection between quantum field theory and string theory that is based on this category theory thing. Then there's a logic for resources. So if you have a cookie and you eat it, you no longer have a cookie. Regular logic doesn't work this way, but linear logic is a logic where implication consumes the thing you're implying from. So water, an H, and another H, and an O implies that you have two HTO molecules, but these are gone then. So it's like a funny looking lollipop of implication symbol. This is very closely related to patronets. In fact, here you see something very similar. Two tokens in a HTO molecule thingy, two oxygens, and then you get this. So this was known that this is the same. It was known that this is the same. And after about 10 years of struggling with this, somebody finally showed that this is the same. And I was like, see, I was right. You can do a lot of these things with these patronets. So same shit, different wrapping. So is this then a universal language for processes or something towards it? Well, okay, so I'll put on my patronets head. So this is kind of my expertise. But since it's all the same thing, I can also say I'm a string theorist. Actually, I cannot. But here you see patronet used in systems biology, like a virion, infected, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, is patronets, is that all that state box is? Well, these are not just patronets, they're stochastic patronets, so they speak about the behavior in the large. You need something like executable patronets, so my particular life insurance at this particular day as a patronet. And so this is what Statebox tries to do, and turns out you need more category theory for this. But I won't blow you away with that today. So what are patronets? That's what I'm trying to explain to you soon. And to do that, we're going to explain what a finite state machine is. So outline of the talk, I'll go from state machines to PetriNets to Statebox. Then I'll give a demo and I'll show you about the future stuff. So what's a state machine? How do you compose it? What is PetriNet with the Statebox? We're going to do Internet of Things, a traffic light. Traffic light, first we need to abstract it in order to turn this into mathematics. So traffic light has three lights, red, green, yellow. Excuse the orange. So states, I can say the possible states that a traffic light can be in is this set S, and it's either red, green, or orange. Yellow, I'm sorry about it. So we're going to abstract it further. We're just going to make the letter shorter and remove the actual traffic light. But that's just the states. What about the transition? Because it doesn't go from yellow to green, right? It goes from green to yellow and from yellow to red. So using these arrows, we can indicate which transitions exist in your state machine. So a recap. We have a set of states, R, G, and yellow. And we have the transitions. So the transitions are these three functions from two things. They go from one thing to another thing. So notice that the traffic light is always only in one active state. It's either red or green or yellow, right? It's not a Heisenberg traffic light. It's both green and yellow. That wouldn't be good. But more about that later. No, just kidding. So it's a set of states and transitions. Now,
why is that move? You call it destination. That's
oh yeah, we can call it target. I don't know. I hate giving names for things. I like to think in symbols, so we don't get these arguments. no offense, that wasn't meant as a. I mean, that's just easier to talk about complicated stuff if you don't need to. What I mean is maybe to elaborate it. If you're in the red state, that's your source state. Now, if a transition fires when it goes from red to green, the target state is a green state, or the destination. So you're going from the. You can think of this as a space that has only three points, and I go from my source red to my green point, and I go to my yellow point, and I go back to my other thing. Huh? Okay. I mean, it's a good question. Names are always very hard to pick the right names. So imagine we're in this situation. We have two traffic lights now and one car. This is all fine, they're red. But what if this happens? Two cars, both go green. We don't want this, right? And I ask you to use your imagination to apply this to blockchains. There are certain situations where you don't want the money to go both to the hacker and to the... So that's kind of my point. So back to this composition thing. Can we do the same thing? Like, you know, we've seen this now. Can I do finite state machine plus finite state machine is again a finite state machine? Well, let's try. We take two traffic lights, and now we're going to say what's the possible states of this composite machine? Well, so there's this S set. Oh, well, it's two traffic lights, so they can be either red-red, red-green, red-yellow, etc. This is a Cartesian product. And so there are nine possible states of my new machine. So my new machine is much more complicated than traffic light, because traffic light had three states. This one has nine. So, okay, we have these states. Then either the first traffic light goes to green or the second traffic light goes to green. Okay, this is all fine. But what about this yellow, this lower corner? That's the corner of death. We don't want these situations. So if we go from red to green to yellow for this left traffic light, then we go back to red. And then on the same side, we can do the same thing. So now this avoids going into this state. Basically, we don't need those anymore. So there we go. We added two state machines into a bigger state machine. Can we do better? Right? Because it's all nice. Yes, we can. Because we have all this fancy stuff. So we've seen how to compose finite state machines. And what they are. Sorry, I like to use stupid pictures from time to time. So now we're going to show you what the PetriNet is. And it's basically a generalization of this thing to having more than one active state. So how do you do this? You allow what is called a hyper edge. This is just a fancy word for an edge that has multiple sources and multiple destinations. So the cleanest way to approach this mathematically is to just place a box in the middle of this things. So I'm going to split my, first I had just nodes and arrows. Now I have circles and squares and arrows. And okay, I have this box in the middle, and now I can draw two arrows outside of the box. So this would mean it goes from one state to two states. This is the point, like if it, this is probably the point where it gets vague for people. So here you can ask me questions as well. So there's now this thing where a transition can be enabled or disabled. The example I gave you with the traffic light, it always just keeps going. There's just one possible transition after each state. But you might get to a situation where you need, where the transition is disabled because there's only one condition is fulfilled. Only when the second condition is fulfilled, it changes its color to indicate that it's enabled, and you can actually transition from that two things to the one thing. So we start like this, maybe. We have this net, this process, and then it transitions, and now we have two tokens over there. So that's how it works. Same thing with just some other tokens hanging around. So don't confuse these for ICO tokens, they're very different. Same situation, it just consumes one token at the top, produces them at the bottom. Although this was a joke, there's also what I call a deep embedding where a token would actually be a token, but that's for future research. So I'm going to show you two examples of this in interaction. Not here. So this, oh, right. Where's my thing? There it is. Sorry about that. This should look familiar now. So I have one token over here. This transition is enabled. If I fire it, produces a token over here. And now suddenly these two transitions can take place. Suppose the first action happens. Still this thing is not enabled. Second action happens. Now it's enabled. And my process has terminated. So this could be used to model a situation where two people need to press a button before you launch a rocket, something like that. North Korea. This is a different example. It's maybe two people working in a factory, and the middle thing represents a pile of parts, and the guy on the left is producing parts, and this guy is called consuming, is consuming parts. It's called the producer-consumer example. It's another classical example. This thing is enabled, takes one token, produces two, moves it around like this, and you see them piling up in the center, right? And now this guy can start eating them up again, whatever he's doing. Maybe he's making Barbies. I always like to think of them as making Barbies. Like one, because Barbie has one head and two arms and two legs and one body, so you have this kind of complicated relationship between the parts. Anyway. So, well, I'll show you my Barbie producing patronet later in another talk. So those were two interactive examples. So now we're going to redo the traffic lights, but this time as a patronet. So it's two traffic lights, redux. So we start with the regular state machine we had before. Now we change the edges. We put these boxes in between. See, very simple. Now it's a patronet. So now we're going to put a death prevention token in the middle. It's the thing that ensures that we never have two green lights. In order to do that, we make sure that this token is consumed whenever a light goes to green. Then, whenever we go back to red, we can put the token back again. Right? So this is now two traffic lights glued together with a token in the middle saying, like, as long as this token is here, both traffic lights are red. Or put another way, the moment the token is gone, there's a traffic light to green, so there's people in the middle of the traffic crossing, potentially. Intersection. Yeah. Intersection, exactly. So note the reuse. I can abstract this away. I have my traffic light, and I can pull out this death prevention token and I kind of glue them together. Now I have three traffic lights with nine states, and that will be 36 states in the other, oh, 10 states. It will be 36 states in the other situation. So this is much simpler, and it's more like conceptual. So that's kind of rough example. Why is it doing this? So yeah, no, I know why it's doing that, because I'm gonna show you this in interaction again. I wish I could have shown you this in Statebox itself, but I suck, so I cannot. This is two traffic. traffic lights in shockwave flash technology. So they're both red. If I turn this light to green, you see how the tokens moved, and now the transitions that are enabled are different. So I can only move it forward to orange, and only then can I move it back to red. And now I can move the other one to green, you see? And so maybe this one goes green again. So this is how you can constrain certain actions from happening, which is something very important for blockchain stuff. Where's my cursor? Oh, over here. So that was an example. So we've seen kind of the history. We've seen how you go from state machines to PetriNets. And then we'll go to what Statebox is. So I'll give a short demo now. And then we'll talk about the future stuff and some relation to smart contracts. And that's it. So demo. Can go do this. Annoying to business, to screen business again. Here. Statebox. Go. Okay, this is arguably not a very good demo, but anyway, this is the status of the system like right now. What you see here. Yeah, so this is kind of fake, not entirely fake. This is real. So this is a PetriNet that's pulled in from a binary format from a blockchain. And this is the, yeah, this was something weird that started happening now. Sorry about that. But normally you can move these things around. So you don't need to put any layout there. It's just the protocol itself. And this is the traffic light example, right? But now as a sort of smart contract in binary form that you can see here. And on the left, sorry about that. This would be the history of this machine. And this is what you store on the blockchain. So when people interact with the machine, the history is stored on this blockchain. So it's open for inspection. And if you want to undo something on a blockchain, that would be cool for a change. So that's actually possible, right? That's just an abstraction.
Is there any scripting language at all? Because we're not looking at
that. Yeah, so we're actually not looking at that. And that's there's more. There's far more than this. So there is, in fact, a scripting language. And this is actually a so-called logic programming language. So it's more like Prolog or Kaskalog, if anybody knows about this, or Flix or Datalog, or lots of programming languages that give you a guarantee that they always terminate, which is something that the Ethereum virtual machine doesn't give you. Well, I also didn't show a type system behind this. The type systems allows you to automatically create forms or APIs. So you just describe a person as having a name and an age and a gender, and the name is a string and the age is a number and the gender is a boolean, for instance. What I also didn't show you is PetriNet folds. So there's you fold a function over the history. For those that do functional programming, they will know what this means. So that's how you actually program this thing. Also didn't show you how you make bigger processes operatically by just dragging boxes together. So you don't have any more wires. This is where it started getting really nice. I also didn't show you the deployment. So I've been experimenting with various different ways. So the idea is that you can just deploy this to Amazon or Ethereum or just completely decentralized using IPFS PubSub. So no consensus. Oh yeah, and the reason why I'm saying this is because I'm giving a talk next week at SHA 2017, this very large hacker conference. This is a one-hour talk. And there I will be going into a lot of these things. So hopefully I've fixed my demo as well. So how is this better? This is kind of pre-conclusion, pre-summary. Why is this better? First of all, it's declarative. We say what we want to do, not how. Nobody, I didn't tell you how you actually execute such a thing that just happened, right? And it happened in a way that was congruent with the semantics, according to the semantics. Like, did what you expected to do. Secondly, it's total. So the type system, all this stuff allows you to check all the possible flows through your smart contract. So there's no undefined behavior. It's diagrammatic, visual, and this one is for future research, but the idea of changing your contract and still, you know, like what the Augur guys just had to do, but then in a more formal manner.
Is this more conceptual?
No, this is all very concrete, or I don't, what do you mean? These are all properties of programming language. So total programming language doesn't allow you to make a partial function that if you give it some value, it doesn't, like a smart contract that has some, you know, if you give me a number from 1 to 10, I'm going to do this. And then don't say anything anymore. And you give me a number to 11, and I just go, yeah. And there goes your ether. So that's non-total programming, because you're not specifying all the numbers what happens. And so we're using this language called Idris, which is a totality checker. Well, I actually have it open now, and I can just show you total of a transition thing, and then
is
it.
Is total programming the same as logic programming?
No, but it's very related. So we have functional programming, and there you can do total programming. So Idris can be a total programming language. Logic programming is a way of programming with relationships. It's slightly different, but related. This kind of tries to combine these things. So it's a mix of functional programming in a. That's in my conclusions.
Do you have like a whole hello world example to show quick?
Like what?
Hello world or something.
The traffic light.
The traffic light was the hello world, yeah.
but I mean, as in a script form. Literally hello world.
Let me show you. Have you ever seen Prolog? So give me 1 second. So this is what. Sorry, few images. So this is what the language looks like. In Simba's case, you have facts. So John likes Jane, Jane likes John. This is a fact, it's kind of a database. So your blockchain is your database here. And then you have these implications. So if X is friends with Y, if X likes Y and Y likes X, then they are friends. That's what this is. And so this is all kind of. There's always more, but then I have to give a 1 hour talk.
No, but thank you.
No problem. So that's logic programming. That's part of the declarative thing. Diagrammatic, you've seen that. This is also interesting, but anyway. So why is this so very blockchain? Well, first of all, I think the most important thing is visual understanding of a smart contract. Before you engage in it, you're not going to audit the contract yourself and make sure it does everything they say it does. And often it doesn't. I mean, we've seen so many hacks by now that they thought it did, and it didn't. So now you can visually, at least, you can look at this thing and say like, oh, well, it will probably do that or that. You can click it through even. So that's nice. We can actually give correctness proofs, and the entire system is so small, it's very mathematical, but it's very small that we can prove the correctness of the compiler. So unlike Serpent, we will give you a proof that we actually respect our rules. Right? So this, for me, every time something gets hacked, it's a great example of why you want to do this more modern style of programming on a blockchain. Why in particular it's so important to do on a blockchain? Because the stakes are so high. You can target different chains. So I'm not fixed to Ethereum, although I'm targeting Ethereum. I can also, it runs on Cosmos as well, or it actually uses Cosmos right now for development, but I can compile these contracts to Ethereum contracts in various ways. You can compose smart contracts, so you don't have to build your fifth reputation system again. You just take an abstract reputation system that has a bunch of holes in it, and you fill in the holes. It's immutable, anyway. It's very, very much related to oracles, right? So you could think of a square as being a calling out to an oracle. We've heard them just before. State channels are also very related technology, and the key point here is that I'm not using a Turing machine. That a Turing machine, for those that know, is abstraction of a computer, and it just reads and writes to memory. We're using something very different, much arguably cleaner. So the main applications of such a technology. First of all, analytics and KPIs are so much more powerful on something like this. You know exactly which flows your people, your users of your application take. You can make a Markov decision thing that says, I'm at this state, 20% of the people go that way, 60% go that way, another 15 go that way, and 5 go that way. And then you can use that information to optimize your process. because everything is declarative, the language is very abstract, we can target different systems. So you get an, after you drew such a PetriNet, a state box thing, you get an API, you automatically get a UI as well that didn't really show, and we can have an app running out of this. So no programming, just draw the thing and you get all these things and all speak to each other. Finally, you can build hybrid systems, so you can have a distributed ledger technology, but also clouds, and we can even target hardware with this because it's so abstract. And now you can have these things running in the same system. Oh yeah, right now I'm working on Swarm.fund, which is an asset management. Well, it's related to assets, and to, in order to manage the assets, we use these processes. Think about airlines, flight tickets, payment systems, customer lifecycle, insurances, supply chain transparency, something I find very important and probably very useful application for this. Compliance, chain of custody, who did what, when, and did they sign, you know, you have to sign each transition with your private key. Most interesting is probably process chain automation and optimization. So you have different companies that need to cooperate with each other. Now, this is already a good use case for blockchain because it's public and all these people can talk to it. But now we can even use process language to define, like, and then how are we going to do this? It's no longer like send me this spreadsheet and then Marietje sends the spreadsheet back and then blah, blah, blah. No, we have a formal language to describe this interaction. Okay, shortly about future plans. We're going to have a summit in Croatia. It's going to be a few people, but the people that work on this project pretty soon. If you're super good and you want to help, you're totally welcome. Also, if you're not super good, I guess, I don't know. it just turns out that this is really difficult stuff, so not so many people get it right away. ICO. One of my friends is doing the ICO for Truebit and Raiden and two other ones that I forgot. He's going to help us do this ICO as well, which will be from Liechtenstein. Very interesting stuff. I'm thinking, yeah, November is very probably not going to happen, but we'll try. In related to this, there's of course work on a white paper and a research paper and a paper about blockchains in general and how you look at this as a mathematician. Yeah, there's research and development that I think I left out. I'm going to conclude again. So you've seen a visual language for speaking about multi-party protocols. Arguably, you know, traffic lights are not like humans, but they're still agents, and there's still two agents communicating with each other. So, you know, use your imagination to imagine they're humans. You've seen that abstract algebra improves. We haven't really seen it, but I've tried to make this clear that this is what gives us this well-behaved system. And probably the most important thing is that with the distributed ledger systems, we can do this on a global scale. And this is, for me, the most exciting reason to work on this and why I went so abstract and so bold with this, is you can do process optimization applied to the whole planet, basically. Of course, this is a long stretch, but you can actually do this. And it wasn't until we had blockchains that this was possible. I also like the acronym, but anyway. But this is big, because now you can just look at all the different processes we have and figure out exactly where do we need to target something to actually meet CO2 targets and things like that. So yeah, this is Statebox, or at least part of it, and now it's for questions.
Mentioning the Technical University of Eindhoven.
Yeah.
Which platform do you use to illustrate these things?
There are many systems. There's one called PN Editor.
Thank you so much.
There are many different systems, but we're building our own editor because PetriNets are just part of the solution.
Yeah.
I can maybe. The things you saw was OmniGraffle. I don't know if you know OmniGraffle, but that's like,
OmniGraffle.
That's the only reason to own a Mac, in my opinion.
Yeah. Producing OmniFocus and Omni these things. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Yeah. So OmniGraffle. PN editor. This thing. I can open one. not the most organized person in the world. Let's take this one. So this is a process that we used for a previous company where I was the CTO, my colleague in the back with the sunglasses. So yeah, this is how you could, you know, how you model these things. I don't know. This is a person picking up, a hostess picking up the customer. This is one way that you would apply this, let's say, to the travel industry. There's also the great SPN editor, it's a very nice editor. Anyway, yeah. So
thank you so much.
No problem.
Well, there's also, I think on the roadmap, implementing web services, for example. So I have your stateless machine and web service, and I can actually go to a more legacy system. Definitely.
Yeah. So that's what I try to allude with the hybrid system. So this ran, what you just saw ran on Amazon. This one runs on Amazon, but you can also, you know, because it's the same language, you can target different systems. So that's definitely a way for enterprises to just start first on their current cloud setting and slowly move bits of your protocol to a blockchain. And you don't even need to say, like, I'm going to use Ethereum, right? We can, of course, target different blockchains.
Yeah, so, yeah, of course, a lot of talk about Web 3.0 or
whatever,
and you have always, like, two layers in
infrastructure.
Yeah. So you have this base layer, the blockchain layer on top of that, and they can interact with
Absolutely. This was the original motivation because, I mean, I wanted to combine video with audio, simple as it sounded, and then 15 years later I realized this is not so easy because they're very different domains. If you think about it, this process has to come up with a sample every 144,000th of a second. So that's, but in the system it works fine, you know, the different colors of the wire have something to do with how quickly the wires are updated. This works very different, right? This is running on your GPU.
Are you expecting something going visual like this, like, you know, like with building blocks, like a smart contract interacts?
Yes. So what I didn't show is the other editor. I can maybe very quickly show you something like this. Running. No, it's not. Okay, well, why is it not running? Sorry, it's not running. Maybe I'm missing. Well,
it's coming.
No, it's still, it has to go in there. But so it's all going to be very visual. This is actually the lowest level that you're looking at, where you see these nets here. But you'll be able to build them from this program. And then later we're going to fold these things into little blocks that you just stack together. So
I
it's.
Testnet, you know, testing it, and then
yeah, exactly, yeah.
Okay.
So yeah, that's very much
cool.
Well, so. Oh, thank you. Yeah. I thought so too, otherwise I wouldn't work it for 15 years.
Yeah, would this be good for actually writing the blockchain protocols themselves, the blockchain software?
Yeah, for sure. So this is maybe a point to pull out my research slide. This is what I call, don't skip slide. So this is the there's this thing about categories, that if you have a category, this is a stupid idea. So if you have a category, what was your question again?
Yeah. No. Whether this could be used to actually write the blockchain software.
Yeah, right, exactly. Mm-hmm. So you can have these points and then these maps between points, and then you can have maps between things, and this goes on up until infinity.
Mm-hmm.
Once you kind of close this loop, you get a language that allows me to write the thing itself. And you know, I started writing the daemon that could execute these processes, but I was thinking like, wait, but my API for my daemon is a process. So then, you know, another 10 years later, turns out this is very hard to do, this closing off without sort of exploding all the rules. But once you do this, and in a limited setting, you can already do it. So this is Petrinets and state machines are definitely used for network protocols. So it's, yeah, for sure.
The only input to these is kind of the state transitions.
Yep.
So if I have like a list of state transitions, it's deterministic, the same thing will happen every single
Exactly. That's how you reach how you program this thing. You just fold over the history. And that's stored on your blockchain. So it's,
sure.
Yeah, you got it. Yes?
Yeah.
two sort of related questions. First, you mentioned some good applications for it. Are there also some things it would be typically very bad for? And related, is this language Turing complete?
Yeah. So I'll start with the second question. It's not Turing complete. And this is by design, because I can slap guess on anything, and then if your guess is limited, your thing stops. So for sure now it's no longer Turing complete, because the Turing machine doesn't do it. There's infinite tape and infinite time. But you can use this to your advantage. So if I restrict myself to terminating processes, this obviously keeps running forever. Right? But the other example I showed with the two, with the split, you remember it? That thing is terminating. So it turns out there are certain restrictions that you can check on this thing while you're drawing it that make sure that it terminates. And if you have two of these things, I prove that if I put the two together, it still terminates. And that's why both this composition and this total declarative non-Turing complete programming is so important. And so things that wouldn't work so easily right now, well, a lot of things won't work right now, but in particular, I mean, let's say current ICO contracts are already kind of complicated. They're also not very workflowy. Right? It's just you buy the thing, you wait, you can expand it. So that's kind of overkill. That will be kind of harder to do. Still, afterwards you would have proofs that all your transitions terminate, but yeah. So the actual like hardcore data processing, that's not there yet. And if I, in the meantime, go back to the research, so this is why with this ICO, what we're aiming to do is to start basically two things. So one is a research institute that has real scientists. So real mathematicians, people that I know, that really work on the super abstract stuff. And they will work on these future things. So we actually have a plan. Like I start now with a limited setting, then I go into one step more. But we start from the ICO, a research team and a development team. That's why I had these two bullets here. Right, research and development. That's going to be the two results. And the development team will focus first on the core and then on different industries. So maybe an ambassador for travel, ambassador for supply chains, things like this. So it's obviously a very, very big project, if you can model anything with it. And so this thing in particular, information game computing, if you know a little bit about Prolog does terminate. But if you make, it's basically a search problem. If you give it many variables, it also still terminates, but maybe after the universe has terminated, because the search problem becomes so big. So this is something we're working on, which is super important. And that's a way to quickly search through these things using multi-armed bandit techniques. A friend of mine, Anthony, is doing this. So yeah, I don't know. I think this in itself is already a Fields Medal, but anyway. While we're at this slide, and the other thing is compositional game theory. So when we're talking about these stochastic processes, they are used to model the behavior of many people in the large, so all the agents of the Bitcoin protocol. Game theory is something similar, where you prove that there are certain states where everybody likes to remain. So I'm gonna remain like with my current Bitcoin client behaving as is because I make money or whatever. And if I switch, I might lose money. So these things are called Nash equilibria. There are various different forms of equilibria, and people never thought you could compose games. So I was like, prisoner dilemma. Well, it isn't exactly like, you know, your Augur contract or something like that. Prisoner's dilemma is a very simple problem with two prisoners, and they can do very little. They can either default or not. But in compositional game theory, and this was completely freaky, just three weeks ago I was invited for a workshop there, and they're using almost the same language. So really, really bizarre. But yeah, that's a way to compose the games. And so there's definitely a similarity between these two things. And this would give you like a proof that your protocol behaves the way it should in the wild. So if you think about the Kaspar paper for Ethereum, there they try to argue that this system has certain, you know, good equilibria where people remain and the system behaves as expected. And so that's something you could do with compositional game theory. So this is very cool stuff. Also hardware for security, you know, like we know everything right now is broken. This is a way, because the core program is effectively, you know, like a bunch of rules with a search problem, so it's declarative. This allows you to create new hardware that will just execute these programs, and that's it. There's input, output. I mean, you can even bake the program into the hardware.
When it's not true complete, maybe I need looping? Or
yeah. Yeah, so you can do loop in different ways. You can loop. So you're programming on top of these things. So whenever, let's say, this thing happens, you can have a little counter in the corner.
Yeah.
And that's your like your logic database. So you there's guards on whether or not these things are enabled. So there's a lot of details that allow you to do this stuff. But you can also, like, if you want to loop, let's say in a process, like here I obviously want to loop forever. But if you're doing a thing and it can cancel, you don't want it to forever cancel, so that people, like maybe with voting, after 3 times say, okay, screw it, referendum, done, something like that. So there's actually very often that you need a loop that runs infinitely many times. So you can do things like unfolding and stuff like that.
It's like making minutes and seconds for the duration of the time.
Yeah, you can give a time limit to how long it should go, yeah. Is that what you meant?
No, I mean put seconds. We define seconds. Seconds is the thing. Are the things that we define them. So we can do this to put the in the divided sectors.
You mean seconds as in this time unit?
Like this one. Not to, like to get out of the loop, you know, just maybe.
Sorry, I don't understand the question. You mean that you want to give a time limit to how long something runs? Or?
Yeah.
So you can do this kind of stuff. Yeah. The problem is though that you need to do it in a very weird way because we're trying to keep these proofs. So this is maybe the biggest difference between Ethereum and these. I come from the programming language theory angle. We want to. The most important thing for us is these properties and these guarantees, and that you can still compose them. So if you want to add something, you cannot just add it. You need to figure out that it also respects your composition and all these things for it. And that's like the big difference, I would say.
Where can we find out about the ICO for state bonds?
Well, right now you can go to my amazing website, this one, statebox.org, and I made these stickers, so as a sort of reminder, because that's the address on there. And then you can fill in your email address, and I will email you for updates. So there's a ton of stickers there. Just made them like stickers. So then I will update you when because this is all just happening very. We're also busy with the swarm.fund ICO, so I'm involved with that. Interesting project, and that's also consuming some of my time.
How much money are you trying to raise through the ICO?
Well.
Yeah,
I think it's a little bit soon, right?
It is a little bit soon, yeah, but I'm starting to hear very large numbers from people.
What do you expect? What do you need?
Well, actually, I don't need so much. So if you want to run a research team and a development team, you need very good developers. So let's say like 15 to 20 millions, you can already run for 1 year easily. If you want to do more stuff and, I don't know, maybe... Cameras are on, right? But maybe you want to do something similar to what other large players are doing,
yeah.
Such as JP Morgan Chase or Consensus. You might want to raise more, but I'll leave it at that. It's really too soon.
So just say maybe you come back on Wednesday in November, December. We talk.
Yeah,
about, right.
Maybe come back in when I talk about the ICO in particular and the details are fixed. Yeah.
Good job.
All right.